Therapist Thrival Guide, where we cover all of the things that graduate school didn't teach you. My name is Miranda Barker. I am a licensed clinical social worker, and I have been a therapist for a little over a year, during that time I've been here at Ellie. And I am joined with my co-host, Dr. Lucas Volini, an LMFT that has been practicing for a little over 10 years.
Yeah, I've been practicing for 10 years, licensed for about 6 years, been with Ellie full-time for 1 year, and prior to that, I was in higher education as a professor at the master's level, the doctoral level, always marriage and family therapy. I got kind of tired of writing peer-reviewed articles and was fantasizing so much about making YouTube videos.
There you go.
Figured I'd go to Ellie.
I love it because we make awesome content for therapists, for other clinicians, as well as for clients. Yeah. Now, this podcast in particular is called Thrival. It is the therapist survival guide. We don't want you to just survive. We want you to thrive. So each episode, we have new guests, all of which are affiliated with Ellie in some way. Some of them are clinicians here. Some of them are just guests on this episode, on this podcast. But each episode kind of dives into a different topic that is helpful topics or helpful tips, helpful ideas, things that you didn't learn in grad school.
Yeah, I think that's a big piece. You know, grad school with accreditation, with licensing requirements, there's so much that you have to teach and have to focus on. And I certainly felt that as a faculty. You know, not everything is the super relevant, interesting stuff. You know, you need those basics. But then once students kind of hit the real world and the professional realities of being a therapist, there are a lot of things that can be incredibly difficult to manage, especially when you don't anticipate them. And grad school can't always get to that, can't always cover it. And so, you know, we're hoping this series can fill in a lot of those gaps.
Absolutely. Because as you know, there's so much that you learn about being a therapist in the therapy room while you're doing it. But this is kind of like a cheat sheet. We're getting therapists in the room to talk about these different things and what they've learned so that you can incorporate it into your own practice and feel like you're a more effective therapist.
Yeah. And so it's not going to be like therapy models
or
research.
Oh, no.
It's all the kind of intangibles that exist between a lot of the things that surround kind of our work with clients, realities of the profession that too many people have to navigate on their own.
Absolutely. Yeah. So today we are talking a little bit more about what does it mean to be a therapist? What brought us to this field? What are the implications on our personal life? How do we balance this? All of that good stuff. So without further ado, I want to introduce our guest that we have here today. Do you want to go ahead and introduce yourself?
Yeah, perfect. Thank you. I'm so appreciative of this opportunity because when I was in grad school, I always wanted to not just to get the academic part of it, but also what it's like to be a therapist. It's such a almost philosophical question, but we'll get into that later. So I appreciate you both for this opportunity. I'm Xoel Gonzalez. I'm an LPCC. I've been with Ellie for 4.5 years. Before that, I did about 4 to 5 years of ARMS work and in-home therapy, which I'm so grateful that I was able to do that. That's really the grinding part of therapy. You learn a lot. I've been licensed for about 2.5 years now. And I recently became a supervisor, which Lucas, you were part of that training, and I learned a lot. It was a pretty awesome experience. So I'm a little bit acquainted with you, and I just met you, so we'll get to know each other a little
Absolutely.
Bit more.
Absolutely, perfect.
I think, did I answer all those questions?
Yeah, you did.
I did.
Awesome. Okay. So what do you do at Ellie now?
So I'm in office in the St. Paul Clinic. I supervise a few folks, and I specialize mainly in persistent mental illness, and I have a heart for mostly mood disorders and what we call the really challenging humans, right? So that's what I do. And I run a group, also Rule 29, which is the 245I. They changed the name. And I do that for part-timers.
Okay, so like a consultation group?
Yep. Okay. I made that really long explanation.
No, I just wanted to make sure I was following you.
And a lot of this stuff varies state to state.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, Rule 29, it's just a interdisciplinary consultation group where all the providers get together to talk about cases.
It just dawned on me that probably comes from a statute then, if it's Rule 29. That makes sense. Okay. Well, awesome. So, Lucas, what do you want to share about this topic? What does it mean to be a therapist?
I mean, that's a big question. Even when we were mapping out this episode, like, that topic was obviously relevant, you know, but I think it's something I've always kind of thought around more so than ever really digging into it with a focus. But yeah, I mean, that's a loaded one. Our profession is definitely distinct. It's different. Like, our day-to-day realities don't reflect, you know, much of what folks who work in more traditional, like, business settings, you know, or other industries. And so it's a lot, you know, there's a lot of integration between our professional work and our personal work, which can make things complicated and tricky. You know, there's still a lot of stigma around it. So when it comes to kind of how it plays out in our personal relationships, you know, that's another added layer of complexity that we deal with as therapists. But really, I think, you know, especially when we look at it from the perspective of grad school, it's like we're learning about super relevant stuff. It's like everything we learn about in the pursuit of attaining the knowledge to help people live better, you know, more fulfilled lives, we're learning about ourselves every step of the way in that process. And, you know, but as we do that, it's not always clear, like, how we integrate all of that and what it always means. And so when I think about being a therapist, I think what's difficult about me answering that question objectively is, like, I've been so invested in that process of synthesis that it's hard for me to think about myself as a therapist without just, like, thinking of myself. Like, it's just so embedded and ingrained.
It's a huge part of your life.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So maybe before I kind of get too lost in that one, what do you all think?
When I saw the list of episodes, I gravitated towards this topic because I'm so curious what I come up with. And I'm still working on that. I think that's the beauty of it, that we're still trying to figure that out. What does it mean to be a therapist? I think you have some sort of idea, but it's not fully... it's not something that you can really put a finger on it or put it in a box or have it figure it out. I think the process of searching that meaning is the fun part. That's what keeps us moving forward. I didn't have much time to prepare for this podcast. I never done a podcast, but I figure I'd do a little bit of work. And there's two questions, like, what does it mean to be a therapist? And the second question was...
I could tell you what the second question is. Yeah, let me see. What does it say about who we are as individuals, and what are the implications of such a peculiar profession on our lives?
So I couldn't separate those three questions. They all jumbled up. I tried to separate them, but I couldn't. But then I went back to the roots of why I became a therapist. And what I was longing for was to really serve, to serve in a capacity that I got also something out of it while helping others. Yeah. So I figured early on that it's a helping profession. It's serving others. And then from there, how do we do that?
Mm-hmm. When you were going to school or thinking about going to school to be a therapist, what population were you hoping to serve at the time?
The most challenging ones.
Really?
Yeah.
You're like, I'm going to dive in and, yeah.
Because those usually are the ones that often get marginalized. Mm-hmm. And sometimes even discriminated and not paid attention, enough attention. So we can work with folks with anxiety and life issues, right, and challenges. But then what about those who are a little bit harder to treat, to work with, to understand, to serve them? Yeah. And often those get left to the side, mm-hmm. you know? So my heart was going towards, like, how do we serve really the ones that really, really need the help?
Yeah.
That are not getting it.
Mm-hmm.
And to be honest with you, I don't know a lot of people that want to do that, mm. you know?
No, and it's, yeah, you're on a short list of people who want to sustain engagement with that demographic and that clientele. Generally, you know, as you said, it's folks who definitely tend to have the highest level of need, but those are also the folks that tend to get like the brand new therapists.
Hmm.
You know, like when you're first getting into the profession, it's a lot of the job opportunities are community-based jobs. ARMS work, which is adult rehabilitative mental health services here in Minnesota. It's people on Medicare, you know, state-funded insurance. That's what kind of gets a lot of these programs going. And so people kind of move through them as a stepping stone to get to the more, you know, kind of posh outpatient therapy office, private practice. But yeah, that's your interest. That's who you're sticking with. And, you know, you said you're just at the brink of becoming a licensed supervisor, which means you have the credibility, you know, to pretty much see whatever clients you want to. But when you talk about you're saying you knew that as you came into this profession. So it's like, what were your experiences prior to that that led you to even know that those clients existed? Because I would imagine you knew them before you were a therapist.
And that's what all these three questions get all
yeah.
mixed up, right? There's a certain makeup, I believe, that we're drawn to serve folks with mental illness or just life issues. And often we experience ourselves that either with family members, friends, your upbringing, and we are curious. We notice those things. At least for me, that was my experience. So I was surrounded by family members with severe mental illness, and I was just curious what was going on in their heads. What was making this human being act in a certain way or talk in a certain way that it was not kind of appropriate to society standards? But I saw them as being marginalized. At least for my generation, mental health was not something that it was talked about that often.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So that was my upbringing. And I tend to look at that as the seed of why that I became a therapist, because that was part of my upbringing.
And were there, who else around you was as curious as you were?
Well, my dad is a psychiatrist.
Okay.
So pretty much all my life, I heard him talk about mental illness and educate us about mental illness and the curiosity of it and trying to figure out ways to help some of these folks.
Mm-hmm. So it was just there in your family system.
Yeah.
What about like outside of your family, like in your community, in your peer group, you know, were these things that your friends were interested in being curious about and talking about?
No, but I did have friends with mental illness and neighbors with mental illness that I saw. And for some reason, at a young age, I was just talking to them, trying to engage and just being curious, really.
Yeah. Yeah, so and it sounds like your curiosity, well, there's the component of wanting to serve and wanting to help, but then also the intellectual aspect of it. Like you wanted to understand and make sense of why some people, you know, have gotten to this point in their lives and why others haven't.
Yeah. Yeah. And also the how to connect as well. Mm-hmm. And how to, in some way, develop that relationship mm-hmm. without the stigma, just human to human kind of thing.
Yeah. So I think a big part of what it means to be a therapist is like what led us here in the first place.
That's exactly what I was thinking. So, I mean, Xoel just shared a little bit about what led him to becoming a therapist, but I don't know if I really know what led you, Lucas, to becoming a therapist. What brought you here?
I mean, honestly, I can't, I don't know what else I would be doing. I was always super curious. Like, I was always paying attention. And I was always, I feel like I always had kind of that organic sense of when somebody wasn't okay. Mm. You know, like in school growing up, you know, just kind of, you could see it in people's eyes, you know, if you look and if you pay attention. And like, it was clear to me who wasn't okay or who was okay yesterday but isn't okay today. But I didn't know what to do with that. Mm. You know, it's not like that was nurtured or talked about. And I was a Chicago Italian. So it's like we're either angry or we're not. That's kind of the extent of emotionality and emotional communication within that cultural group, you know. But growing up in a suburb outside of Chicago, it's like diversity was everywhere. You know, there were kind of all walks of life in my high school. There was the full range of socioeconomic status. You know, there was the private golf course neighborhood. There was the working class neighborhood. And there was the government housing. And we all kind of filtered in. But to me, it's like it wasn't diversity. It was just life. You know, that's just what the world was because it was all I knew. But especially as we started to get older and I kept paying attention to who was suffering, who was okay, who wasn't okay, who was popular and had friends, who was struggling socially, things started to fall into patterns. You know, it's like this neighborhood seemed to have more of these, you know, kind of struggles. This neighborhood had those struggles, you know, and so kind of the variety of life got me super interested and fascinated by kind of those larger system factors at play. Because once you kind of see those patterns emerge, you know, that there's even more complexity that you need to dig more deeply into. And so my whole upbringing was just kind of like a pursuit of making sense of why my life was different than everybody else's and why everybody else's life was different than everybody else's. And so psychology always made sense at the undergraduate level. And a lot of this too, like it was an intellectual pursuit, but I wasn't like it took me a while to identify as an intellectual person. Like I didn't really do school. Like I love school, but like I didn't have a backpack. I didn't even have a locker. Like I would just show up and I would just observe. You know, I was so fascinated by all the social dynamics. And so I didn't learn a ton in the classroom, which made college difficult, but I learned so much just from paying attention and experiencing life that it prepared me, you know, for this profession, especially once I figured out how to do the academic stuff. It's like those are lessons I would never give back. And then so psychology just kept me super stimulated. That made sense. Then when it came to grad school, I assumed I'd stick with psychology, but I was at there was like a graduate school conference on my campus, you know, and off into the corner there was just a older gentleman with a great mustache. And I always notice a great mustache, you know, and if I'm in the room with someone with a great mustache, I will talk to them at some point. And so I eventually gravitate toward him. Sure enough, he was the program director of a marriage and family therapy program, which I had never heard of, you know. And so I was like, what's marriage and family therapy? And he just started to explain how, you know, psychology focuses on the individual and the psyche. Marriage and family therapy understands the individual based upon all the things that surround them in their system and how all these multi-systemic factors and that, like, that's where I cut him off. And I was just like, sold. That makes way more sense. I'm going to go do that. And it's just been a nonstop pursuit of getting more and more knowledge. I want all the knowledge. You know, that's what I love about this field too, is we're all lifelong learners, you know, and as we learn more about the profession, we also learn more about the world we're living in, which I think is one of the coolest things.
gosh, I feel like I went about becoming a therapist kind of opposite ways as you both in some ways, because I didn't really know what I wanted to do even in college. Like, I got my associate's degree in liberal arts because I was like, I want to keep my options open. We'll see how this goes. And then transferred to a larger university, got my bachelor's in social work because I came from a family of adoption and wanted to work in the adoption field. So then I got my bachelor's, worked in adoption for several years. And actually, I started out working as an adoptive family worker, like writing home studies and stuff. And my supervisor pulled me aside and was like, hey, can you do some birth parent counseling or expectant parenting counseling on the side? And I was like, okay, I guess I don't really know anything about that, but you know, I can learn. I'm interested. I'm curious. And then I started doing that. And then within like a year, my caseload had completely flipped to only doing birth parent counseling, really, because that was what I loved. Like, it opened up this whole new side of my interests professionally. And I was like, man, this is what I really love. I love building a relationship with these people. And it wasn't just birth parents. It was primarily actually expectant parent counseling. So like if anyone was experiencing an unplanned pregnancy, or if they were wanting resources, maybe they were in like a lower income, then they wanted like various resources, or, you know, things like we could help them with rent or help them with like getting baby stuff, that sort of thing. And so did that for a few years. And then like as I was working there, so much of my caseload was mixed up in child protection. And I was like, I'm so frustrated. I feel so powerless. I want to be able to make a change in the system and meet the women and the parents over here, because this is where the most change is going to happen. And so then I went back to grad school, got my master's in clinical social work, and still kind of with the idea of like, I'm going to be doing county work. I'm going to be doing child protection investigations. And I did do that for 3 years, and I loved it, but quickly realized that it wasn't sustainable for me. I mean, I got burnt out on it and felt kind of lost in the system. But as I imagine a lot of the parents I worked with felt. But some of my good friends, they also were clinical social workers, and they started working within like the therapeutic setting. And I realized like what I loved about working with parents and working with expectant parents or parents within the child protection system was I love building relationships. I love helping people kind of become a better version of themselves. I love to help them problem solve. And so it was kind of a slow progression over, you know, 8 or 9 years where I realized this is what I'm meant for. But it was little tiny tastes of that throughout my professional life. And then now as a therapist, I specialize in adoption. I work with kids that are in the foster care system. I work with kids that were adopted. I work with birth parents, adoptive parents, the whole thing. And it feels like I've finally like pulled all of my interests together, and I'm able to actually build relationships with people in a way that are right for me, and, you know, living authentically. But that's kind of like the long version of my resume, apparently. But there you go.
And so even like we all acknowledged personal experiences and kind of history that brought us here, but it seems that they each also played a big part in what type of therapist we each became.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, like what, Xoel, what you're talking about aligns brilliantly with the profession of counseling. You know, for me, it was always the complexity of like the multi-systemic layers, you know, which is MFT and cybernetics and all that good stuff, and then social work.
Yeah, advocacy yeah. And, you know, meeting people in their environment. It was what I needed, what I love.
Yeah, so to reframe that question, which therapists love to do. It's like, what does it mean to you to be a therapist? You know, because it sounds like we already almost all agree that there's no one answer to what it means to be a therapist. It's more so a process that each individual kind of figures out along the way.
Yeah, and how many therapists have gone to therapy and realized, like, oh man, this is like, I know that in my bachelor's program, I started therapy for the first time, and I was like, oh my gosh, this person that I'm building a relationship with, like, this is so valuable, and it's turning me into a better human. Like, I think so many people who go into this field have personal experiences, either with family members with mental illnesses or personal experiences of mental health struggles, and then wanting to kind of seek out resources or help in that way as well.
Yeah.
And it's kind of hard to pinpoint what a therapist is when I remember this professor, and this stuck with me for a long time. He said to us that being a therapist was a very unnatural thing to do. And I thought about that, and it was a profound question. And what does he mean by that? Mm. You know, because you can't really put a finger on it. What's the difference between a friend and a counselor? A lawyer and a counselor, a psychiatrist and a therapist, a pastor, a preacher, you know, a worker. What are the differences, right? So they overlap, right? And we often get even confused about our own role as a therapist. So that got stuck with me. And because if you put a label on it and said this is what a therapist is, it's not, in my opinion.
And I agree entirely that it is an unnatural thing to become.
Why do you say that?
Well, I think it's unnatural in the sense of, it's like I'm speaking to it like relative to society, and I don't know what this professor was getting at. This is where I go with that is, it's like the nature of our work almost like contradicts the rules of social engagement. You know, it's like, we're not an emotionally sophisticated society. We're not a collectively emotionally attuned society. We're not a society that knows how to communicate well with each other, you know, and nonetheless, it's like, all of society finds ways to organize on a daily basis while being incompetent at all of those things. And we're stepping into a world and living in a world that is trying to, you know, kind of correct a lot of that. And so in doing that, it's like there's a component of being at odds with society. And not that it's problematic, but yeah, like I would say it's unnatural. Like, how many jobs are intentionally engineered to sustain society as it is? And just kind of keep it moving forward and keep it rolling, you know, whereas what we're doing is creating spaces where people can really dig into and challenge and question a lot of those things. And so in that regard, I would say it's unnatural at the very organic level of what therapy is to me, at least when it comes to human connection as a means to, you know, work through suffering and optimize, you know, how well we can be living. I would say that's one of the most like natural jobs you could have. Like that's like, or that's organic, you know, at the level of humanity. So yeah, there are a lot of tensions there.
Yeah. And just to disclose that, whoever is going to watch this podcast or listen to it, I'm not trying to discourage to become a therapist or it's more like you're going to have to wrestle these questions and that's okay to do that. And that's, for me, that's the beauty of it, that you continuously are trying to learn more about yourself and others so you can make some meaning out of it. Maybe you won't find answers, maybe you won't. But that's the kind of almost a natural thing. It's not 2 + 2 = 4, it's 2 + 2 = 5, and why.
Yeah, like we have weird jobs. Like, it is weird what we do. We kind of step right into the things that a lot of people unconsciously kind of avoid or ignore, you know, or neglect. And I think that's where a lot of the marginalization comes from. You know, and maybe that's what you're speaking to, especially with serious and persistent mental illness. It's like we can't just kind of like discard them, and they kind of can live off in the fringes, and we leave it up to the state, you know, to make sure that they have at least their basic needs met. But when it comes to, you know, kind of, it's difficult to step into kind of their reality in a lot of ways, and spend time there to join with them to, you know, kind of see their humanity, because we take that with us then in our next interaction, you know? And so it's like we're constantly being impacted by the experiences and views and cultural contexts and environments of the clients we work with. And, you know, I would say if we're doing it right, as a product of that, it's like we're constantly evolving. And sometimes it can be hard to feel like you're constantly evolving. And I think it could particularly be hard for the people around you, you know, who might be living lives in a way that doesn't provide that benefit, you know, or that resource. And so, like, for me, I know what's always something I learned is, like, how important it is for me to be connected with other therapists. You know, there is kind of a two-year stint where I was kind of like a therapist by myself. Like, I was kind of alone as a therapist. And that was really hard. You know, not only on the personal level, but also it had an impact on my clinical work, you know, because I wasn't as stimulated. I wasn't learning. I wasn't being challenged. I wasn't surrounded, you know, by others that kind of embolden a lot of those curiosities. Things kind of just started to feel stale, you know. And so when we talk about what does it mean for you to be a therapist, I think a big part of it is figuring out what your needs are within this profession to be able to sustain it. And it's going to be different for everybody.
That there, the question was also about how does it affect your personal life, mm-hmm. right, and your relationships? Mm-hmm. Was that part of the mm-hmm. implications of that?
Yeah.
And Lucas, you're right on point, but as far as you can't be an island in this profession. You have to seek collaboration, a supportive environment, and learning how to separate work from being at home. Because if you're not able to do that, it's you bringing work home, and that can cause problems with yourself and your loved ones and friendships. So that, I can't tell you how to do it, but it's necessary. Mm-hmm. And because you don't want to mix both. An example will be, and I'm sure you guys probably heard something like this, where, dad, you are being a therapist. Just be a dad, please.
Yeah, and that's,
you know.
Oh, sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
No, I think that you bring up such an important point that we are discussing on a future episode too, to like how to be balancing some of those relationships and how to, you know, have work boundaries, that sort of thing. But as you were talking, I was even thinking about how when I started out before I was a therapist, or even just as I've been a therapist, I was a different person, you know, and not in a bad way. I was a different person. Like, this profession changes you in some ways. And I believe that I've grown for the better. I have become a more empathetic person. I've become a better listener, better question asker, these different things. But I think that it's hard to be a therapist or, you know, go through this education and stay the same person. I think that your worldview is going to change. You're going through these different experiences. You're hearing firsthand about some of the hardest things that people go through. And so part of what it is to be a therapist to me too is to be growing as a human and adjusting, just constantly learning and adjusting, I think. I don't know. I just, as you were talking about that, I was thinking a little bit more about how being a therapist too is constantly growing and constantly, you know, becoming a new person.
Did I mention about you have to get your own therapy?
No, you didn't. Okay. Tell us more.
Well, I think that it should be a requirement.
I'll tell you the reasons it's not. It's just like liability on the university's end. If we were to require students to get therapy, yeah, then we would have to provide them,
yeah,
with access to free therapy. And there's not a university on the planet these days that has funding for that.
No, I'm thinking more like postgraduate, when you're established professional, that you should see somebody at least once in a while, because you'll learn also from seasoned therapists how they were able to manage all this stuff, you know. Yeah. And my therapist told me not too long ago, you will change in 2 years, in 5 years, you will be a little bit different, even in the realm of being a therapist.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think that there are a ton of benefits to having the experience of sitting on the couch, you know, and it's, I think if you're, you know, it's like you can go to therapy just for the sake of going to therapy, you know, slap an adjustment disorder on you or something like that, you know, or discover that there's maybe more there that you weren't aware of. It's also okay to wait, you know, until the timing feels right. And so you could be an effective therapist if you had never gone to therapy, but when you experience actually going to therapy, you will undoubtedly be a more effective therapist. You just learn a lot.
Well, yeah, because we're talking about what it means to be a therapist, but we neglect to talk about what it means to be a client.
Yeah.
Because if you've sat in that client chair, you have a better idea of what it means to be a therapist, right?
Yeah,
it's uncomfortable. It's hard.
Yeah.
And it's weird. It is weird. We should probably do a dedicated episode on like being a client.
Or even just sharing our first, what it was like our very first intake appointment.
Yeah. I'm like a nightmare client. I'm a horrible client in therapy. I go into it knowing I already feel bad, you know, for the therapist. And it is weird to work with therapists as clients, you know, so we might dig into that one more on a different topic. You know, so I do think that's important, you know, and that's just speaking more to the integration of kind of who you are as an individual and who you are as a therapist and how those do intersect, you know. But that notion of kind of constant growth, I do think that's an important one, you know, because if we're not growing, it's like, are we doing therapy right? That's a question that, you know, I think that's a very valid question to ask. But, you know, the piece that I go back to with it is, again, because we're always growing, it is pretty critical that we have people in our lives that are also growing too, you know. And it doesn't mean, they don't all need to be therapists, you know, they don't need to be growing like us. But, you know, when you're always growing and you're in relationships with people who are just kind of staying in the exact same place, it could be really hard to sustain that relationship.
Oh, yeah. And we'll talk more about that. I think it's episode 8, but I'll have to look back on it.
Yeah. You know, and I think, you know, to be a therapist, yeah, we're stepping into a different kind of profession. We deal with a lot of things and realities, and we perceive the world in a way that kind of can contradict or go against the grain of kind of mainstream society. And so a lot of how we view the world, it won't always translate, you know, to everybody else. We're in a profession where if we're doing it right, we're constantly evolving, we're constantly changing, we're constantly growing, which is one of my favorite things about this work. But it's another one of those aspects where it can complicate things outside of it in our personal lives. Mm-hmm. I guess maybe I do want one more question we could all answer. It's like, we all knew why we wanted to get into this work, but it's like, once we found ourselves there, is it what we expected it to be?
Ooh, that's a good question. Xoel, do you want to go first?
Yeah. Before I decided to become a therapist, I was a tattoo artist. And I did that for 20 years professionally.
Okay.
Oh, I wish we started there.
What? Yeah. This is new information. Okay. Yes.
And I did it professionally. So I saw thousands of people and tattooed thousands of folks. And at the end of my professional tattooing career, what I was drawn to was actually hearing the stories of the person who was getting the tattoo, why they were getting the tattoo, what did it mean to them? And that's when I realized, I don't want a tattoo anymore. I want to talk to people and listen to the stories, and I'm curious about their lives. And so What was the question?
When you got, so that's, yeah, again, a big part of why you went into the profession, yeah, but now once you got there, did it provide you that? Was it what, yeah, you expected it to be?
So to answer, yes, because what I experienced while I was tattooing and that connection and listening to the story, it was very satisfying. And it seems like the other person also was getting something out of it. Yes, except now I don't have to do the tattooing part. I can just sit and listen.
That's amazing. I mean, the amount of times I've heard people refer to their tattoo artist as like their therapist, oh, or, yeah, you know, going to go get a tattoo is therapy for me. Like, that's so interesting. And it makes so much sense. Mm-hmm. I mean, you were already like most of the way there, right? You were listening to people, you were hearing their stories. Oh, that's so cool. That's, yeah, so cool.
So to answer your question, Lucas, yes, yes, is what I, obviously a little more challenging because there's also kind of some mental illness that it's a little more challenging with biologically or chemistry-wise, yeah, you know.
And I think that is a big reason why people avoid working with the population that you're drawn toward, is because they don't get the self-esteem out of it that they might be looking for. Like, I think a lot of therapists go into this work unknowingly putting a lot of pressure on their clients to get better so they can feel good about being a therapist. And it's, you get that in a very different way. Mm-hmm. It's like, it's still there and you get it, but it's not going to be the clean, polished up, all put back together, you know, client that you just send on their way and then you move on to the next one. Do you still tattoo people?
No, but a lot of folks ask me.
Yeah. I bet.
They still want, including Ellie folks.
That's what I'm saying. Ellie alone could have put you back into business.
In business.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Well, let me know if you ever are.
Like, I'm retired. Yeah.
To answer your question, Lucas, I'm going to say no with an asterisk because, like, the first thing that I thought of when you asked that question was, I did not know there was going to be this much paperwork. Like, oh my gosh. When I first started working as a therapist, I was so naive and I scheduled, I want to say 17 intakes, diagnostic assessments for my first week.
Easy.
Oh my word. Like the first, and then there was, you know, 17 the week after that. And the first few weeks of being a therapist, my husband was like, what did you do? Like, because I was writing diagnostic, like learning how to and figuring out how to write a diagnostic assessment over and over and over. Oh my word. And so that was like my first taste where I was like, this is not what I was expecting at all. But now that I've kind of gotten over that initial, you know, DA craziness, I think some of the work that's in the office, like when you're with your client, like, yeah, that is a lot of that is what I was expecting. It's more fulfilling and rewarding than I was expecting. And I enjoy that. But yeah, I mean, just I think there are a lot of aspects of being a therapist that I didn't really think about in grad school. I didn't really, you know, I mean, I knew we had to do DAs and treatment plans and progress notes and all these different things. But like, that was challenging for me to learn and figure out as a new therapist, and also like learn how to, you know, bring the client into that conversation a little bit more and how to, you know, make sure that I'm capturing what their goals are and not just I think that you should be doing this. Obviously I want to do that, but you know what I mean? And there are aspects like logistically that I'm like, yeah, yes, but no, is my answer with that. But
okay.
Yeah.
And we'll spend some time in other episodes talking about paperwork.
Oh, thank God.
Yeah. And some tricks of the trade.
Perfect. That'd be helpful. Well,
my favorite is I'll talk about one of my lectures on how to write a super shitty DA.
Oh, and
the
perfect.
Super shitty DA is the one that like just barely rises above the threshold of like minimum requirement.
Oh, no.
You know, that's okay to do. And it's an art.
D's get degrees.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Not in grad school, they don't.
No, they don't.
So these will be C plus DAs.
I love it. I love it.
I would say you said no with an asterisk. I'd probably say yes with an asterisk. I would say my disappointments with the field have a lot to do with just like the at the professional level, you know, kind of like how some of the professional associations roll.
And how expensive they are.
Yeah, how expensive it can be. The fact that there's no national uniformity between licenses, I think, is a really big mess and disaster. You know, like even there are plenty of states that won't even know what an LPCC is because they don't have LPCCs. They have LPCs or some of the other variations of that discipline, which complicates things as far as like moving. But yeah, I would say the biggest disappointment is just the nature of the health, like insurance companies, you know, and that's a really big battle. You know, we have ahead of ourselves right now, but none of that, you know, that's why it's yes with an asterisk, because all of those things don't have anything to do with the moment that I'm in my therapy space with a client. Mm-hmm. You know, like when I'm in a space with clients, I would say that's a hard yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I love it. And I think that this is a really good transition into, we have some amazing episodes planned for you guys this season. We are diving into clinical documentation. We're talking about ethics. We're talking about balancing personal relationships and work relationships. We're talking about, you know, how to find your niche, how to set boundaries, all these different important topics, things that we didn't learn about, maybe things that surprised us about the profession, things that surprised me about the profession and going into this. And so we have an awesome season planned. But before we completely wrap it up, I wanted to kind of give the mic back to Xoel and say, if you had your supervisees listening to this podcast right now and you wanted them to maybe do some self-reflection, or if you wanted to impart some advice to them, I know I'm putting you on the spot, but what would you want to say?
As far as like what it's like to be a therapist or just in general?
I think as they're navigating this field.
This field. Okay. To be patient and to learn about yourself as much as you can, and to maintain curiosity and a love to serve. That's what I will tell them.
I love it. That's perfect.
All right. Well, so Miranda and I will certainly see y'all next time. We'll have a revolving cast of guests, you know, which we're just pulling from the pool of Ellie therapists.
Pool of amazing Ellie therapists.
Yeah, and so we'll keep things relevant, keep things rolling, and yeah, looking forward to the next one.
Awesome. Thank you. Thanks.